Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being there this evening. I, Architect Mildred Jones, extend a very warm welcome to all the participants today. We are on the fourth and the final day of the webinar lecture series organized by the Center for History and Archaeology. We have had three eminent speakers in the earlier sessions sharing with us their views on three varied and interesting topics. As I move on with the introduction of the speaker for today, I would like to remind our audience that our chat box will be open 15 minutes before the session concludes. Kindly feel free to use the chat box for posting your queries. With that introductory note, it gives me immense pleasure to introduce our speaker for today, Dr. Shailendra Mohan Jha. Dr. Shailendra Mohan Jha is an associate professor at Department of History, Deshbandhu College, University of Delhi. He has a teaching experience of ancient Indian numismatics to postgraduate students for more than 32 years. He has done his MPhil and PhD on numismatics, the earliest coins of Indian history, from History Department, University of Delhi. He has published more than 15 research articles in the Proceedings of Indian History Congress and other journals. His research papers are cited 17 times by the ResearchGate and Academic EDU. He has also attended conferences in World Archaeology Congress, Numismatic Society of India, Indian History Congress, Archaeological Society of India. He is also a proud member of more than 10 national and international academic societies. With that elaborate description, I request your attention and help me welcome our speaker for the day, Dr. Shailendra Mohan Jha, who will be enlightening us on the topic Evolution of Coinage in Ancient India. Over to you, Dr. Jha. Sir, please come on board.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. Before I start, I confess two things. First, during this COVID period, I feel a little bit mentally dull. Dullness is there. And secondly, I will use bilingual to express myself easily. I restructure my topic, evolution and problems in ancient Indian coins. With my personal experience, I will share first. I thanks three teachers, my three teachers, Professor K.M. Sirmali, who taught me in first year history honors in St. Stephen's College, and again at MA level, he taught me numismatics of 100 marks. I also thank my professor, R.S. Sharma, who always guided me, and Professor D.N. Jha, who taught me socioeconomic history paper at MA level. This is one. Second, my experience in my research. After my MA, I joined MPhil with JRF, and I selected Panchmark coins of Bihar as my research topic, since I know that Magadhan king and Magadhan empire had monetary economy. So I searched coins, Panchpa coins in different museums of Bihar. I'm just telling you one experience of Patna Museum. When I reached Patna Museum to study coins, first they asked for letter from department. I gave them. Then on the appointed day, director of Patna Museum, curator of Patna Museum, and two his assistants were present, opened the coin rooms by director, then by curator, opened the almirah of coins, took out the coin shelf, and two assistants, one photographer, one person for taking where they were present under the CC camera, and I with my notebook and clipper to the shape of the coins. Every time when I asked for one coin, first director took it out from the coin shelf, give it to curator, then curator, after checking the everything, he handed it to me. For 5-10 minutes, I studied that coin, then I gave it to photographer for photographing and for weight. This way, one coin took me more than 10-15 minutes. By lunch hour, hardly I could study 10 to 15 coins, and after post lunch, hardly 10 coins. So not more than 25-30 coins per day I could study. In this way, I share with you, I studied more than 12,000 coins in Patna Museum from 84 to 88. I used out of 12,000 Pratima coins of Patna Museum, 6,000 for my PhD research, and rest 6,000 data are still with me, and most of these coins are still unpublished. In course of my research there in Patna Museum, I also got invitation from a museum of Patna City. Dr. Jalan, Jalan Museum of Patna City had full of sacks with silver Panchma coins, and no one was ready to study those coins. I hope those coins were still there or it's studied. So this is the problem of research, seeing the actual coin for any research. Anyway, I studied 12,000 coins. So today I will talk on general evaluation and problems of coins with special reference to Panchma coins. Generally, we divide ancient Indian coins in three stages. First stage is from 7th century BC up to Mauryan period. Second is after the post-Mauryan, we have coins of Republican states. And third, that is die stacking gold coins of monarchical states like Kushan, Satvahan, Gupta, etc. So I start with the first phase, 600 BC to Mauryan period. In my class, the first question I asked my students, what is a coin? I asked them to have a coin on their palm, and after seeing the coin, just tell me what are the features. And on the basis of their reply, I explained that coin is a metallic piece. What is the use of that? To purchase something. That is, coin is a medium of exchange. So the term exchange, I took and explained regarding the evolution of coinage. During the Stone Age, we do have exchange system. It was barter. They used to exchange stone tools, tools of different stones. They also exchange animals, fruits, etc., etc. But there was no need, no evidence of any medium. After coming to agriculture phase, Neolithic phase, again we find barter system was there, grains were exchanged, but medium was not there. So if coin is a piece of metal, then after arrival of metal during the period or for that matter, winning bronze coins are not available. It means coins are more than a metallic piece. It is a medium of exchange. So I compare the situation before 6th century BC and after. What are the situation before 6th century BC? Harappan civilization was Bronze Age civilization, urban civilization. We have metals, we have metallurgy, still we don't have coins. We have long route trade, even we don't have coins. It means more than metallurgy, more than urbanization, coin requires something more. What was that new thing in 6th century BC? 6th century BC, a new metal arrived 200 years before, that is iron. With the arrival of iron, we have two very important effects. One, making of weapons and making of many artifacts, iron tools for agriculture purposes. These two effects of iron led to emergence of state in 6th century BC. Emergence of state with kingship gave one new direction. What was that? If coin is a piece of metal, then in ancient India, we don't have value written on any ancient coins. Value of ancient Indian coins depends on the weight of the coin. So each time a user could not weigh the coin. So the presence of a person, presence of a ruler, presence of a king was necessary to certify that this coin is of certain weight. That political situation emerged only in 6th century BC after the emergence of state, when king certified the exact weight, putting his mark on the coin. Second thing was the purity of metal. The technology involved in purifying the metal was known even during Chalcolithic period, during Bronze Age. But here what we find that extracting metal from mines, purifying them, and then manufacturing coins up to the 96% pure silver. That is the special thing with the emergence of coins. So not only weight, even the purity of coins, purity of metal, that was certified by the king of 6th century BC. Third thing, that in 6th, 7th century BC, with the arrival of iron, craft production increased. We have data. The total archaeological remains before 6th, 7th century BC and after the arrival of coins. And we find that enormous increase in craft production after the arrival of iron. So coins was needed as a medium of exchange. So coin is particularly a medium of exchange for economic purposes. Now, we start with punchmark coins, evolution, origin, etc. Punchmark coins are of two metals, silver and copper. Out of 16 Mahajanpadas, 16 states in 6th century BC, we have coins of four monarchical states and few republican Ganasanghas. Not all Ganasanghas had coins, and the reason for that, not so much economic progress, and also not to access the mines and natural resources for making the coins. So Panchmark coins, if we study the features of Panchmark coins, what we find? We find first its shape and size. We find so many symbols on obverse and reverse. Now we trace all these things. First, the symbols and weight. Generally, in ancient India, we have two weight standards. One is known as Karsapan, that is 32 ratti, and second is Satman of 100 ratti. Ratti is the basic unit of weight. So two weight standards in ancient India, Karsapan and Satman. Out of those four states of 6th century BC, we have different patterns of Panchmark coins. For example, as Michael Mitchell classified, heavyweight and single punch for Takshila and Gandhar, heavyweight and multi punches for Kausal, lightweight and single punch for Avanti, and lightweight and multi punches with Magadhan coins. Now, it means two types of weight system, and if one per is basic 1 rupiah of today, then we have different denominations of those weight standards. For example, we have Karsapan, we have Masak, we have Kakni, and even up to Ardh Kakni coins are available. Ardh Kakni is present day half paisa coin. So just think the intensity of monetary economy and coins. 1 rupee, 1 pan is divided into so many denominations, and during Mauryan period, or from 6th century to Mauryan period, we have bimetallic currency system. That is silver Panchmark coins and copper Panchmark coins. And both these metallic coins have their inner relationship. Conversion from one metric coin to other, they are dependent on weight. So 32 Rati Karsapan coin was equal to 4 copper coins, like that. Now, this is the one part. Second is the symbols. We have generally 5 to 6 symbols on obverse and 1 and 2 bold mark on reverse. In my teaching, I asked my students, if we have different symbols on different coins of different states, different Mahajanpadas, can you trace the history of those symbols in that locality? Suppose Magadhan coin has 3 arch symbol present on hill. Can we trace the history of 3 arch hill other than coins in Magadhan locality? Similarly, we have lion in Avanti. Can we trace that symbol from other materials. It means those particular symbols were popular before the arrival of coin, and with the popularity of that symbol, they were placed, they were punched on coins of that locality. Now, tracing the symbols, now I move to manufacturing. Manufacturing, on the basis of which I divide three phases. First is punching technology. Here we have two types of manufacturing coins. One is making the metal sheet and then cutting into several pieces. And when that piece fabric was in semi molten condition, they used to punch symbols on them. Due to very limited space, four or five symbols were overlapped. After punching symbols on those fabric, they again took the weight of that piece of metal. If the weight is more, then they used to trim the side of the fabric. The result was that sometimes symbols on that fabric was also cut. So partially half symbols were visible. In course of my research, I found very, very difficult to identify those symbols on punchbowl coins. After manufacturing punchbowl coins through this metallic sheet, what we find that the remains of cutting of metal from fabric, they used that material also. For that, they adopted the second method known as globule method. All the remaining metallic powder or pieces, they again melted it and they placed it either in water or on hard surface. It took its own shape. After that, they punched symbols on that fabric. So, two manufacturing of punchbowl coins from sheet and from globule method. Seeing the size and shape of punchbowl coins, there are lots of controversies. Generally, we have two persons who studied symbols of punchbowl coins very rigorously. One is P.L. Gupta, Parmeshwari Lal Gupta, and Durga Das. Before my study of coins in Patna Museum, Dr. Parmeshwari Lal Gupta was curator of Patna Museum. He had worked there on punchbowl coins. He had very elaborate recording of all those punchbowl coins in one coin register. But still, many, many coins were left. I completed that. So, P.L. Gupta, on the identification of symbols on punchbowl coins, classified them. He classified punchbowl coins on the basis of symbols in seven categories. On punchbowl coins, some symbols are constrained, like first symbol, sun symbol, solar symbol, second is known as six arms symbol, and then third, fourth, fifth. Even the first symbol, solar symbol, we have two, three types. In the beginning, the rays of sun were not very fine, not size of the rays was not the same, but later on we find very artistic sun symbol on punchbowl coins. Similarly, we have many varieties of six arm symbol, second symbol. And after that, we have so many symbols changing. For example, the fifth symbol changes, then fourth, third, second, and first are constant. So Pierre Gupta tried to identify those symbols which states Janpada, which mint, which area of circulation, etc., etc. And in that categorization, he placed human figures on punchbowl coins in the last. It appeared very late. Before that, there is no human figure on punchbowl coins. P.L. Gupta did not consider weight and size and shape of punchbowl coins. In his opinion, symbols are sufficient criteria for classifying punchbowl coins. Well, Didi Kosambi studied punchbowl coins. He did not agree with P.L. Gupta. He took two conditions more. One is size and shape, and second, weight system. According to Didi Kosambi, every after 12 years in course of circulation of punchbowl coins, weight of coin is reduced at the rate of 0.2 gram. And he also mentioned that after 12 years of circulation of coins, one person in charge of circulation of coins, Lakshanadhyaksh, he used to put one mark on the reverse of coin saying that it is all right. Still, that coin can be in circulation. So on the basis of reverse marks and weight of the coin, Didi Kosambi came to this conclusion that there is some relationship between the weight and symbols of coin, and it is related with the age of the circulation of coin. In theory, in principle, this can be very good basis to classify coins on the basis of weight and reverse marks of punchbowl coins. But here, when I researched punchbowl coins, I found two problems, two limitations of Kosambi's theory. One, Didi Kosambi, who studied, I think, more than 6,000 punchbowl coins, mostly Chakshala Gandhar and others, he assumed the number of population which handled the punchbowl coins and also the volume of punchbowl coins. If 100 persons handle 100 punchbowl coins, its rate of reduction of weight will be different. If 100 coins are handled by 1,000 persons, rate of reduction of weight will be different. Since in ancient India, it is very, very difficult to know the population, total population, and total number of punchbowl coins at a given point of time. So being the very good scientific criteria for classifying punchbowl coins, I did not agree. When I researched on my 2,000 coins, I found that Didi Kosambi theory cannot be applicable. I took weight of punchbowl coins. I studied symbols of punchbowl coins. I collaborated. I made many graphs and found that no, this is not possible. We have different results. For example, D.D. Kosambi assumed that in square coins, in rectangular coins, because of handling of coins, square coins are more prone to linear degradation, more prone to reduction of weight because of its size and shape. So according to Kosambi, finding this problem, Mint Masters changed the shape, size of the coins from square rectangular coins to round coins, which is less prone to linear regression. Well, I again studied, I found this is not correct. Many round coins have the same weight as square and rectangular coins with so many reverse symbols. This is also not proved by study of P.L. Gupta. When I analyze the symbols on Panchmark coins with its weight and theory of Kosambi, it was not applicable. We moved further. When I studied Panchmark coins of Bihar, very interesting result I found that by 6th-5th century BC, Kosal coins had upper age. Kosal had better economic condition than Magad. Its half-pound coin was more popular there. More denomination of coins were in circulation in Kosal. But once Magad started conquering, defeating other 15 states, the result was that Magadhan Panchmark coins with special features of two special features. One, that is Magadhan coins, Panchmark coins were of 32 Karsapan weight standards and it had 5 symbols. So I calculated around 470 BC, Magadhan coins with these two features, that is 5 symbols and 32 Rati Karsapan weight standards became all India, pan-Indian currency systems. So Magadhan economy, monetary economy prevailed throughout India. Magadhan Panchmark coins became all India coins. And after that, we find so many thousands of Magadhan coins as pan-Indian coins. When I was submitting my PhD thesis in Delhi University History Department, so many persons were there. When I criticized Professor D.D. Kosambi, my teachers asked me, you studied only Panchmark coins from Bihar. What is the situation outside Bihar, particularly in peripheral area? I kept mum because I had not studied that. That day I felt the need of any my students who will work on Panchmark coins in peripheral areas. I did not get. The most surprising thing I again say with hard-hearted my feelings that in Delhi, we have 3-4 central universities, Delhi University, JNU, IGNU, Jamia, but none of the university produced any PhD students who have done research on purely coins. Students have used coins as a source, but purely on coins, they have not worked. Professor K.M. Simali had worked on coins of Panchal. After that, I was the person who worked entirely on Panchma coins, did my PhD, and that's why since 1988, I was teaching in history department without any replacement. Other universities don't have any such paper. Even in Delhi University, when I was a student, I had 100 marks numismatics paper taught by Professor K.M. Simali. But when I started teaching numismatics, it was just 50 marks, and even that combined with epigraphy and numismatics as source of ancient Indian history. And last year I taught last year, that was the last year of my teaching there, syllabus was changed. Now it has become monetary history of India. So paper is changed, person is changed. I don't know who is teaching, how is teaching, what is his her research on coins. But I feel when I visit different universities, I feel that the problem I faced in studying coins in different museums of Bihar, and I also visited National Museum Delhi every year, seeing the actual coins, I know the problems in research in ancient numismatics, and that's why people are not coming forward with research on ancient coins. It is a problem of museums also, concept of museum also. I just recall one incident. In 1981, Professor Sharma, Alex Sharma, wanted to see the coins in National Museum. He was denied. With lots of approaches, he could see only coin registers. I don't know. The concept was that coins are there in National Museum only for visitors, mostly foreign visitors, not for study. Similarly, I have this book published from National, very booklet type of thing, published from National Museum Library. I every time send my students there, National Museum, to purchase this booklet in 60 rupees. Generally, they deny. Though booklet is available, they deny. And I have seen that if some foreign scholars, foreign travelers come, they get it. I don't know why. I think, like National Museum, all museums with all precautions, I know the importance of antiquarian, importance of coins. All museums of India should allow all the research scholars to study coins in their institutions. If study of coins in those museums will be easier, I feel more and more students will go there. That is the first phase. That is Panchma coins up to Mauryan period. But again, I told you with evolution, I will tell you the problems also. I indicated few of them. I indicate the second problem of this page. Whatever research has been done on silver punchmark mines, that much research has not been done on copper punchmark mines. It is very difficult to identify symbols on copper punchmark mines. It is very difficult to know the bimetallic relationship between silver and copper punchmark mines in circulation simultaneously. My friend in British Museum, Dr. Selend, I talked to him, I read his articles. Even there, we have punchmark mines in British Museum, even there. Not any path-breaking research on punchmark mine has come. For example, we have punchmark mines, thousands and thousands of punchmark mines, but still, we don't know exactly the price of different commodities from 6th century BC up to modern period. We know that cash salary was given to army officers. Taxation was given in cash during modern period also. Money was in transaction in market, but exact value of coins, value of different commodities, are not known. It means coins were studied for its physical features. Still, proper use of coins as a source for economic history is desirable. Not done. Lots of information from coins were not applied in economic history. Now we move to second page, post-modern page. Punching technology had its own limitations. Every time they had to punch 4-5 times on reverse, 1 or 2 times on reverse. Nothing was written there. We have copper punchmark coins, but after post-modern period, two new things emerged. One, centralization of power like modern disappeared, and emergence of many Gana Sanghas, Odambrad, Yodheyad, Ajunayan, Panchal, etc. See the tragedy. Just one book on ancient Indian Gana Sanghas, republican systems. After that, we don't have any book on Gana Sanghas of 1st, 2nd century AD. We do have History of Panchal by Professor Simali. We do have tribal coins, history books on tribal coins. But the detail of all Gana Sanghas of 1st, 2nd century AD is still not written. History is not written. The major change in post-modern period was that copper became the metal of coin. Manufacturing technology changed from punching to casting. I don't know whether it was because of metal, because of copper, but by 1st century AD, we don't find any coins manufactured by punching technology. though its circulation continued for one, two century later or so in South India, in North India, but manufacturing of punching coins with punching technology stopped. And its place, casting technology emerged. What was the advantage of that? In casting technology, first we have nothing was written. Uninscribed cast copper coins. We had many such coins with symbols, but symbols were changed, not exactly of punchmark coin symbols. Then we have inscribed cast copper coins, names of kings, names of dynasties, sometimes other things also written there. So with casting technology, what we find, again, evolution within casting technology. First, the mold was most probably of wooden mold, one coin at one time, but later on, what we find, technological advancement in casting technology, as Birbal Sahni has written a very good book. Again, the only book on cast coins, manufacturing of cast coins, and he found that Rohtak method of casting coins was the best. In that manufacturing technology, different channels of molds were used, and simultaneously they had symbols or something written on both sides, reverse and obverse. And 8 coins in different channels were produced at a time. So it was easier, no wastage of metal. And if it is metallic mold, they used to just record the coins from that mold. So we find many such molds in Rohtak and other places. So that was the second phase when we have in uninscribed and inscribed cast copper coins. But the problem in study of cast copper coins, again, we have so many. For example, the nomenclature. Sometimes it is called tribal coins, sometimes Nigam coins, sometimes Janpat coins, etc., etc. After many discussion and seminars, what we find that historians agreed with one terminology, that is Janpat coins. These coins should be known as Janpat coins. Similarly, the problem of weight. Similarly, the problem of chronology of circulation of these coins. Similarly, we have problem of language script there. So we have many problems in cast copper coins also. In course of my teaching, I try to find out how a particular language script used for coins and a particular language and script used on inscriptions. Similarly, we also tried to find out whether coins which mentioned the name of the kings, names of the dynasty, do we find any other evidences of that king and that dynasty? In some cases, yes, in some cases, no. The third page, we have That is, again, the third techniques of manufacturing, die striking coins. And here, for the first time, we have gold coins. Satavahan and Kushan both were monarchical states. With die striking manufacturing technology, we again find evolution there, different phases of making coins with die striking technology. Obverse only, then reverse, like that. But the features of die stacking coins are, for the first time, we have very good quality of images. Images of king, images of god and goddesses on reverse, titles of the kings. And the best thing that we compare those images on coins with the sculptures of that time. Images of kings and his ancestor in Devakula of Kushan are the same as we have images on Kushan coins. So here we have some sort of comparative study of images on coins. For the first time, we have beginning of very big legends on coins indicating the titles of the king, Maharaja, Rajati, Raj, like that, which finally culminated in Gupta period with full Sanskrit artistic poem-like titles. One more thing with the die stacking coin is the artistic posture of the king and god and goddesses. As we know, Kushan kings tried to assimilate Indian cultures on their coins in the form of placing Indian gods and goddesses on their coins. Bhima did it with Shiva and Nandi. Similarly, Kalisk did it. And a particular type of inscription, a particular type of image of gods and goddesses were for just circulation in a particular area. Beyond Northwest India, inscriptions on coins, images on coins of Kushan kings were different than within Indian border. So, with the help of Kushan coins, die stacking technology, we have for the first time names of kings, titles of kings, date of their reign, images of gods and goddesses, script and language. For example, we have three languages, three scripts on coins: Brahmi script, Kharosthi script, Greek script. Similarly, we have Sanskrit, Prakrit, and Greek. So these coins are very, very helpful for writing history. Little bit on South India. We study from linguistic point of view Satavahan coins. It is multi-metallic currency system prevailing in Satavahan kingdom. The most popular metallic coins in Satavahan period was lead, 14. Just imagine the balancing relationship of all those 4-5 metric coins. How did they manage? What was the economic repercussion of that? And we also have Indo-Roman gold coins of the same period. Coins of Satavahans are very good source of listing the names of the kings. We find many coins of those kings who never issued any inscriptions. We also have many kings mentioned in inscriptions, but their coins were not found. So numismatics provides very good source for making the list of Satavahan kings, but what about economy? In these last 6 months, I heard many webinars. I heard many South Indian historians, scholars. I asked them, what was the monetary economy of South India, Satavahan period onwards? I know coins of Sangam age. Historians have worked on that. But only physical features of those Sangam age coins are published. Those informations on Sangam age coins were not collaborated in their economic history. Similarly, in Satavahan period, we know that paddy transplantation, crop productions increased during Satavahan period. That's why there were multi-metric currency system there. But what was the exact nature of monetary economy? We don't know. Ajit Shastri and others have worked there. But my question is whether the relationship of Satavahan king with South Asian states, Indo-Roman trade network, what was the internal impact of that on Satavahan period? Does it influence the production of paddy and other spices because of that external trade? What was the nature of export imports in so many poor towns of South India on the basis of coins? We still don't know. After Satavahan, Sangam, we hardly have coins of Pallava and Chalukya and beyond. Monetary system of Satavahan disappeared. Though powerful states, powerful kings emerged, but economy was such which did not require coins. Here again, in North India also, we generally stop by teaching with Gupta period. After Gupta period, hardly very few coins of Harshvardhan are available. And after that, nothing. It's paucity of coins. The entire monetary economy changed. I remember Professor Arya Sharma's question. He tried to ask us, those who were working on coins. He asked us to visit different museums of India and find out the total number of coins in that museum. with their chronology. We tried, gave him the data, and on that basis, he again formulated that post-Gupta period, actual coins in different museums of India is very less in comparison to Gupta period and before. So on the basis of availability of coins in different museums of India, he tried to theorize that it was feudal period when long route trade declined, paucity of coins, self-sufficient rural economy emerged. Though recently I have read few articles where some scholars tried to locate few coins in post-Gupta period, but their numbers are very less. We know the arrival of Indo-Sassanian coins in post-Gupta period, but that is after lapse of 100, 200 years of Gupta period. What was the economic situation in post-Gupta period regarding the coins? Why there was paucity of coins? Though we have different opinions on nature of feudalism in India, but from numismatic point of view, still, we feel that there is a need to find out where is those coins. I know that coins of modern period, thousands and thousands coins of modern period still lying in different museums, unstudied, unpublished, but those coins are there. We know the coins of Kushan, Satvahan, and Gupta period, Indo-Greeks, Indo-Bactrians, and others, coins are there. We can study in future, but after Gupta period, coins are not there. Not even in outside India, museums of outside India. If you see the publication from different museums of Britain and other places, hardly you will find post-Gupta coins in hundreds. So, from numismatic point of view, a major change in economy we witnessed in post-Gupta period. So, in brief, I can say that in India, the first phase from 6th, 7th century BC to modern period, which I studied, coins are very, very useful for political history, economic history, for history of art also, on the basis of symbols, and post-Mauryan period, coins are very, very important for script, language, history of republican states, Ganasanghas, and the third phase, evolution of manufacturing technology, third phase, we have gold coins, so many information on those gold coins. We have used those numismatic information for writing history, but still, we are doubtful whether Gupta gold coins were actual in circulation or just they were commemorative coins. At the occasion of every conquest, they might have issued the coins because we have certain symbols on there. We have certain legends on coins which indicate that. as Professor Jha, Professor Jain Jha had written, those were golden age for rulers only, for upper elite. The real picture, real economic situation of general public was not so prosperous, but still we have gold coins of Gupta period. So I stop here, surveying three pages of evolution of ancient Indian coins, Panchma coins, cast copper coins, die stacking coins of three different political periods and their limitations in their use for history writing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your session. We are now open to questions from the audience. Sir, there are two questions. I'll just take that up. The first question is from Mr. Manikandan. Do we have evidence of Panchmark coins in northeast states of India?
Very few. Very few. Not more than 100 from entire northeast area. And I doubt whether the trade route Uttar Path and Dakshin Path were connected to northeast states. We have coins in Guwahati Museum, Prag Jyotishpur Museum. I've seen that coins, not beyond that. So still we feel that coins as a medium of economy, economic transactions, indicates the nature of economy, and northeast states of that time was not so economically prosperous to use those coins in course of trade. Few Panchma coins might have reached there, but that was not monetary economy as such in northeast states.
Okay, thank you, sir. The second question is from Mr. Rahul Thomas. Is there a way for us to buy your book?
No, no. See, mentally, I've been discouraged. I'm telling you the reason. After 43 years of teaching, my teacher felt that very few new books on coins were consulted by MA students. Note takers. What we know, what we teach, every year we face that, sir, so many books I have to study. This reading habits is decreasing day by day. My PhD thesis is in Delhi University Library. It's open to all. It can be studied by all. I have articles, not book. Who will study that? Even after 30 years, 40 years of study of Panchma coins, I feel that still thousands and thousands of coins are unpublished in different museums of India. No one is interested to do work, do research on coins. So first history, then ancient India, then numismatics, then Panchma coins, who will study? So specialized book, it discourages me. Seeing the situation, it discourages me. I can speak, I can explain. I prepared by students to speak for 30 years, but not a single student came out with a PhD on coins and able to teach numismatics in any college, any university of Delhi, at least Delhi, I can say. This is a very sad situation on the research on coins and study books on coins. I am life member of Numismatic Society of India. I am life member of South Indian Numismatic Society. Every year, I read their journals. I read many, many other journals. Most of these articles are based on physical features of coins. Those features, those informations were hardly collaborated in textbook. In the last 10 years, I have read textbooks also, hardly numismatic informations were mentioned there. That is a sad situation. Sorry.
The third question is whether the ancient coins of India came into being by itself, or was it an outside influence to the subcontinent?
See, it is said that in the same century, 7th century AD, Lydians, they used metal as medium of exchange. They started coins in 7th century. According to our archaeological reports, we don't find coins in any archaeological excavation before 7th century. G.R. Sharma found it just a little bit earlier, but just single coin. So what I feel that tracing the history of coins in India more dependent on economic progress than just appearance of coins. Economic situation compelled the arrival of coin, and that economic situation was not before 6th, 7th century BC in India. So not before 7th century there is any coins, and I feel Indian coins are indigenous coins, fulfill the requirement of Indian economy.
Thank you, sir. We'll take two more questions. There is this question from Mr. Manikandan. There are some coins that are found from the megalithic sites in Tamil Nadu. What was their intensity? Does similar evidence, is similar evidence found in any other country?
Any other country, I don't know. But regarding megalithic, we discussed that whatever we find in grave goods, that was not produced by people of megalithic culture. Whether it is iron tools, whether it is grains, whether it is a coin, if discovered inside the grave, all those are just reached there in course of transaction, in course of just trade. They were not manufacturing, they were not using the monetary economy, they just stored that, they just collected that, that's all.
Okay, thank you, sir. And we'll take this one last question. What was the use of issuing gold coins if it was not used for economy?
I regard that the best necessity of any coin is for economic purposes. Coin is for the first condition is the medium of exchange. Coin is a medium of exchange, medium for exchange of economic commodity. So coins can be used as a necklace, coin can be used for other purposes, but basically the use of coin is for economic purposes only. And informations on coins can be used for political history, other history, but the basic requirement, use of coin is for economic purposes, economic exchange as a medium of exchange only.
Okay, thank you, sir. There is one person from the audience who has raised his hand, Mr. Vihan Prasad. If the same person wants to unmute and please ask the question, you are welcome to do it.
Okay, sir, you know me, I am Pallavi and I've done my MPhil on numismatics and I've studied the coin governance of, I've studied at least 6,000 copper coins and 400 gold coins of the four museums of Uttar Pradesh. I wanted to know, because my work is not on benchmark coins, I wanted to know that is there a relationship between the coins of the peacock symbol and the Mauryan coins? You know, I wanted to ask that. Otherwise, I can ask you later also. We can have a conversation. Exchange notes. But I thought that maybe...
See, this controversy. This is related with the work of Lakshanadhyaksh. Kautilya writes that Lakshanadhyaksh, with the help of Rup Turk, these two officers collected with coins, Rup Turk and Lakshanadhyaksh, they were the persons who can identify all the symbols of all the Janpadas. And if Mauryan coins, Magdal coins had peacock on hill, sometimes crescent, sometimes peacock. So, as I told you in course of my lecture today, that we have to trace the history of symbol in that particular locality. If peacock is somehow connected with the term Maurya, more, I don't know. But we do have history of that particular symbols before coins also from Magdhan area. So there can be one relationship between peacock symbols and peacock symbols found on benchmark coins, particularly sometimes separate peacock symbols, sometimes on hill. So Lakshadhyaksh could have identified peacock on hill with Magdhan coins, that I assume. But still, the area-wise, we don't know. We only find from the host of coins that coins with certain symbols are discovered from this area in first stage, that is Jalpal state, and when Magal became all India power, that particular symbol became, coins with that particular symbol became all India coins. So pre-470 BC and post-470 BC, we have to find out peacock on hill on coins before 470 and after 470. People have worked, I have worked on those coins chronologically, how many peacock on hill before 470 BC and after that. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Sir, we'll not be taking any more questions as we are running out of time. But for those among the audience who have questions further, may feel free to write to us on our email ID. Thank you so much, Dr. Jha, for accepting our invitation and for engaging our audience with a detailed and insightful session on benchmark coins of several eras and areas of India, and also taking out the time to patiently answer all the questions from the audience. Thank you so much, sir, once again. Here I, Architect Mildred Jose, your convener for today, conclude the final day of the webinar lecture series organized by the Center for Archaeology and History. Last but not the least, thank you so much to all the participants of the webinar and all our well-wishers for making our entire webinar lecture series a success. A gentle reminder. Yes, sir.
Thank you. And I feel that this webinar will inspire few of us to further research on coins. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. A gentle reminder to all our participants to fill in the feedback form. The link for the same is provided in the chat box. It is a humble request to all the participants to enter the same name in the feedback as used to enter this particular Microsoft Teams webinar. Here I, Architect Mildred Jose, conclude the session. Thank you once again for your time. Namaste.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.